Hello, my friends. Hello, my life warriors, wherever you are in the world. Welcome to the Day In, Day Out podcast. Woo! Today on episode 226, I was very lucky, privileged to have Hara Allison on the podcast. She is a photographer, creative director, podcast host, artist, author, and graphic designer of over 30 years. We talked about a number of things: how she got started in photography, what are some of her greatest motivations. We talked about her different sort of picture series, from 50-50 to big, and her self-portraits. And we talked about how she got her podcast started and why she's doing it. All in all, I have to say it was a joy to speak to her. I expect great things from her in the future. And I look forward to her return. So please sit back, enjoy the podcast, and enjoy the show. Peace. Here we go. Hello, my friends. Hello, my life warriors, wherever you are in the world. Welcome to the Day In, Day Out podcast. Today on episode 226, I'm very lucky, privileged to have Hara Allison on the podcast today. Hopefully I did not butcher the name, but that's another story. She is a photographer, creative director, podcast host, artist, author, and graphic designer as well. Anything else you might do as well, superhero?
I play tennis.
Okay, and she plays tennis. How are you today, Milady?
I'm good. Thank you for having me. And my name, just for anybody who really cares, is Hara Allison. It's Hara. Yeah.
You see, I told Hara. 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 Okay, there you go. Yeah.
It's a topic of conversation.
I'm sure it is. Now, look, we were talking about, us being natural enemies beforehand, like you being a Nikon camera owner and me being a Canon camera owner. Apart from the sort of mass, the mad capital investment photography takes its toll, what got you onto photography?
Oh, okay. When I was very young, a little girl, I was always borrowing my dad's camera and always taking really good photos, composing them well, and, very young, 7. And then in high school, I got an enlarger. And so I made my bedroom a dark room. I've always loved photography. I've always loved capturing a moment. And then since college, though, I have been a graphic designer. So for 30 some years, I've been a graphic designer, and always had the passion for photography, but never thought actually I was smart enough to learn lighting. And then just before COVID hit, I went to a conference in Toronto that convinced me that I should follow my dream. Oh. And I picked up a camera again. I bought a camera. And then since then, many cameras and many lenses and all that. But and I started photographing women and talking to them first, having our conversations before we do a photo shoot.
Yeah.
And it's just been a really beautiful experience. And those conversations led to me having a podcast of my own called See Beneath Your Beautiful, which is now a year old. And it's just so beautiful. I just love having real authentic conversations and hearing the stories of people going through adversity, but also coming out the other side, always giving hope. Mm-hmm. That, if you can just make it to tomorrow, you'll be fine.
Tomorrow. I love you.
Yeah, I'll think about that tomorrow. That's a Scarlett O'Hara line from Gone with the Wind. I'll think about that tomorrow. But the truth is, honestly, whatever you're going through, it probably will be better tomorrow. Do you think that?
No, this is the thing. I think what people often get caught up in is they get caught in the quagmire of the moment. And mm-hmm. this is the thing, if you go, I take the approach of yes, tomorrow will be better, it's one of those things which is easier said than done. If you haven't resolved many a thing which has put you in that quagmire, it's going to be a very difficult task to say to move to that tomorrow, because a tomorrow can be a day It could be a moment, it can be 6 months, or like countless years, you know?
I agree with you, but I guess the goal is to get them to tomorrow and not give up. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And like, it's just life is short. And my mother passed away when I was only 18. She was 46. And just this, the missing out on life, living in the quagmire, it just makes me so sad. And so my just goal in life is that everybody sees their beauty and not necessarily what they look like, but their beauty, who they are, you know, and doesn't waste a minute. That's my, I feel like really passionate about living life to its fullest and not missing out.
Mm. But wouldn't you say like people trying to find their beauty, their inner beauty, their out, well, not so much their outer beauty, but that true person they are themselves, their authentic self, that takes a lot of, how can I say, a lot of reflection, a lot of dealing with work on a personal basis.
It does. And the more, it doesn't get easier, I think, but the more you do it, the more in alignment you are with yourself and the more you can love yourself. That's what I think. The more your actions are in line with what your heart wants, that's the real beauty. I'm doing coaching right now. And my sister was like, because I'm talking about childhood traumas where I was sexually abused at 7 and touched inappropriately at 5. And I don't want to talk about it, but I know that there's peace and freedom at the other end of the work. And so I'm willing to do the work. You know, I just can just taste it. I can just taste the freedom of, I just need to figure out one more thing. But anyway, so yes, it is work. It is constant. It's constant work, but I think it's worth it in the end because there's freedom by talking about it and letting go and doing the work.
Mm. This is the thing. Like, I have to ask because, look, 31 years of basically doing graphic design. Okay, what, there must have been some type of epiphanal moment to going, okay, yeah, photography is the thing I'm now doing. What was that?
Oh, well, it was really at that conference I went to. I think that was October of 2019. And I was sitting in the audience. It was about dreamers. And I went because been doing graphic design for 30 years and it's great, but it's not exciting. And so I went thinking that it would reinvigorate me or, you know, excite me again for what I'm doing. And it did completely something different that I hadn't I didn't expect. You know, to tap into what my heart really wants, which was showing people their beauty. And the way to do that is through photography. And boy, did it take off. My whole life changed. And that's, you know, I'm 54 and that was only a couple of years ago. So I love that you can have your dreams and start them at any time. You know, you don't have to be 30, you can be 50. And it's so fun because it's so much my heart. And same thing with the podcast. Oh my gosh, I don't know how much you edit yours, but I take an hour of audio, of a conversation and probably take 6 hours editing it because, you know, every little space, every time they repeat themselves. I mean, I just really edit it just like I do photography to just be this most, the perfect picture. And so that gets me no money, but it's also where my heart is, sharing people's stories. And same thing with photography. I just do it visually instead of audibly.
I see. This is vain. The way you talk, you seem to be a very sort of process-driven person.
Well, what do you mean? I feel like I'm a seat of the pants kind of girl. What do you mean process-driven?
No, basically, look, this is the thing. Okay, with regards to the sort of realm of photography and podcasts, on the sort of creative side, someone who takes 6 hours to edit a podcast, okay, yeah, you might be a seats of your, flying by the seats of your pants with certain things, but there is a process you need to you seek out. Also with the, I would say with the pictures, that's just the reason why I'm pushing back because it's you're going through the process of finding that person's true inner beauty in that moment in time. I could be wrong. You can let
No, no, that's right. That's right. But, you know, it's because it's art ultimately for me. And so I care very much. So that's how, that's why I'm doing it. Otherwise I would just throw it out there, whatever we had. And it's not terrible, but also I know I can sculpt it and make it better.
Ah, sculpt it and make it better. Like, this is the thing with that sort of sculpting and making it better. Would you say like you're putting an element of yourself in like that moment for photography, or is it a case of you're just like, can I find that the trueness behind it all?
I 100% try not to put myself in it. Mm-hmm. Like, even my graphic design, if you look at my portfolio, I don't have a look. All my design projects look like not just the client, but their intended audience. And I feel really passionate about that, especially in photography, that it doesn't look like what I want it to look like, that the model, every time a model says, and I'm talking about just anybody, like,
yeah,
not a, you know, not a fancy model, but any time says, oh my gosh, you made me look so beautiful. I feel really strongly about saying, I just pointed the camera at you and clicked it. You did that. Like, it's them. That's, I'm just capturing them that they've never seen before. So I feel really strongly that it's what they want to represent about themselves, and not like, I do work with some models and they're always like, well, what's your vision? What do you want me to wear? I really want it to be a collaboration. Mm-hmm. I really want to know what their personality is. And then I want them to pick out what they think would work. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because it's about capturing somebody's essence rather than me capturing a vision I have.
And this is the thing, acquiring that sort of skill set of photography. Now, even in today's day and age where like, okay, look, you can get a camera, which let's just say it could power a space shuttle and then some, like so many crazy settings you would like would be intimidating to most. Like, yeah, what was that sort of journey picking up that photography skill set for you? What was that like?
Well, I think because I've been, you know, I used to do photography when I was younger and I've been doing graphic design my whole life. I think I do have an eye for it. I mean, I think that's just innate. Like when I would hire a graphic designer, it didn't matter what college you had or whether you went to school. I think you either have an eye for design or you don't. And same thing with photography. But What I forgot to say was that, so during COVID, I had just started my photography business and then we got shut down. And that was the biggest blessing I had, because for 60 days, I did a self-portrait series and learned lighting, like learned it, because I was a very patient model. I really, really understand it. And I was so thankful, not for COVID, but that I had the opportunity and the time to really delve into and getting the knowledge. Cause like you said, it's intimidating. Photography is intimidating. I wanted to go into photography after college, but I was just really too intimidated that I would not be smart enough to learn the lighting, but it's really not that hard actually.
Well, hey, yeah, no, but this is the thing, like back in the day, like when you like after college for yourself, photography was, how can I say, it was, you paid out a shed load of money on just the equipment, on the lighting, but then it was like, yes, the film, the chemicals.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Like this. So oh, it was, man, like a very sort of, okay, if you weren't, it was a mad hobby to have if you weren't.
100%. I used to work at the Great American Chocolate Chip Cookie Company after school and spent all my money on developing material and paper. And it was a very expensive hobby.
Yeah.
You are not wrong. And the enlarger actually wasn't that expensive. I mean, I guess back then it was like $200, but still that's reasonable. But it was just the material. And like you're saying, oh my gosh, so much film.
Yeah. But like, this is the thing, like, okay, what many a photographer who's like taking up photography now, it's like, they don't know the whole sort of game of risk of, okay, if there was one little gap of light, it's like, mm-hmm. that's everything gone. And
yeah,
like the sort of restriction of like 24 and 36 pictures.
Right. They were special. I really do love the digital age though. I love being able to just experiment and explore and not worry about, you know, how many pictures I'm taking and I can click, you know, because it's really, really, I think it's the in-between moments when they're not posing that is the beautiful pictures.
Yeah, I hear that. And like, this is the thing with regards to sort of photography in the modern age, there is part of me which I like, photography has like so changed in such a dramatic way. It's now become a sort of realm of a hybrid between photography and art, depending on how you do the like edit. And,
yeah.
You know, I've seen people like show me a picture and I go, this is the picture and this is what I ended up with. I go, how did you do that?
It's amazing. Yeah. Yeah. You know? That was fun too. I really, because it was a self-portrait series, I tried to do something different every day for 60 yeah. days. And that was really fun because I really did things I didn't know I could do, you know, editing the photo and making it like making neon. I made fake neon, which was cool. Just things like that. It was really cool. A fun experiment.
Yeah, no, like this is the thing. I can tell you've gone through a number of experiments, like looking at your series, like yes, paint on the face, like mm-hmm. cloning yourself. And yeah, like yeah. there's a really dramatic one, which is in black and white where, yeah, you're like shaking your head.
Oh yeah, yeah, my hair was wet. But that was really just learning lighting, you know? Mm. And it's been really fun. I'm doing a series right now of an angel series. I bought angel wings and I have 5 lights on these models so that, you know, the wings look lit up and they are lit up. And so that's really fun. Just now I remember like, oh, I had 1 light and I couldn't do it. Now I have 5 and I'm totally get it.
Yeah. No, because this is one of the things I like about your website, looking at it. Like you've actually gone into doing a number of different series, which I would say have their own sort of unique challenges, but also have this sort of, how can I say, rhythm and story to them, if you get what I mean.
Yeah,
Like what I see with a number of people who are like, oh yeah, I want to do photography. They'll take pictures, but it's like there is no sort of real focus behind it all, if you get what I mean. It's like, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I just always want to do something new. I really feel like creating is the driving force. And so there's always a thing. I always have an idea ready to go. I'm ready. I have a model coming over later today and I can't wait because I already photographed 2 people for this, the angel wings. And I can't wait to see what the third person will bring to it.
Yes, I think I've seen 2 of the people you had, one gentleman, 1 lady.
My husband, he had to be my test dummy.
He's like, hey, what are you doing right now? I'm trying to watch the game.
I had to give him a long, I said, okay, can you do, and then like, okay, today at 3, right? And like, I was ready around noon, and but yeah, I just like had to wait because he had to get mentally prepared to be the, you know, Lucifer.
He's like, okay. Like, that's a little bit concerning, putting your husband in the light of a fallen angel. It's like, yes.
The pictures are pretty good because he was looking at me devilishly.
Okay. dare I say.
I think I made you blush.
You know what? I think, yes, maybe. But like, yes. Like, I know I can tell you a little bit impish, but that's another story.
I did actually, you know, I did tell him to like smolder. Like if you want to tell how a man should take a photo, they should crinkle their eyes. They should, you know, like look like they're, yeah. Oh, see? Totally.
Oh, okay.
Changes you the way you looked completely. Nobody can see what we're doing, but yeah, if you kind of like smolder. it's a good thing. Yeah.
All right, what can I say?
And when it's a woman and they're feeling all kind of nervous, I have them think of somebody that they love, and it could be a pet, a parent, a boyfriend or whatever. And the way they look at that person and pretend they're looking at that person in the lens instead of me, it changes their face completely. Yeah. So those are 2 good tricks.
Perfect.
Smolder.
Like this is the thing. Would you say, like, through the number of different series you've done, and like, yeah, it's over 5 at this moment in time, from your self-portraits for all the way up to your 50-50 like series, what would you say have been like, have you learned sort of key things about the whole process, either for yourself, or has it been a new sort of realm of self-discovery for you?
I think I've given myself, I like the series more than like a paid photo shoot, because I am allowed to play. Like, I can give myself permission to mess up, which they always work out, but the idea that I can play and we can just have fun and there's no pressure, I really, really enjoy that. And so I think that's what I've learned, is that if you can take all of these things and make it a playtime, then it's completely different. There's just takes all the, it takes, it adds all the fun back into it and takes all the pressure out of it.
And like, this is the thing, like, would you say, like, with your 31 years, which, like, don't believe her, people, she's lying. Like, as a graphic designer, like, would you say you were living more in a restrictive box than you ever could imagine?
Well, 100%, because, you know, I'm self-employed and people are always like, oh, you're so lucky. Well, I have to have a lot of different bosses instead of one. And, you know, it's not art. And so that is why I have fallen to art, because it's not art. It is, there's a purpose, there's a message, there's a target market. And so you have to keep all those things in mind. And so I do think I make things beautiful and appropriate, but also a lot of times the client, this is the number one thing that graphic designers hate, is make the logo bigger. And so those kind of things really just are mess all the designs up, you know, make the logo bigger, fill in the white space. White space is beautiful, people. You know, the empty space is almost as powerful as the message. And so, but you can't tell somebody that, really, you know, if they are paying for an ad and they want to fill it all up with everything. So because it's not art, it's not as exciting, because people have an opinion.
Well, yes, but this is the thing, what I kind of look at it and go, yeah. Like, the hardest thing I would say you can ever do for anything when you're making a product or design or anything like this is making it elegant. It is nigh on impossible, because you can, like, by the time you think about it and go through it again and again and again and again, you bells, whistles, like, everything gets added on. Because, like, okay, most successful logo I can think of just come into mind, the Nike logo.
Yeah.
It is a tick.
Right. It's a swish. It's a swish. Right. Swish. And so I try to help clients with that too. I really do appreciate simplicity in design. And they're always like, well, I am, this is just like a fake example, but, you know, I am a massage therapist and a photographer, and I want to convey all of this in the logo, and I love purple. Well, and then I say, okay, the Nike has a swish, you know, like a swoosh, whatever it's called. Yeah. Anyway, the logo doesn't have to say every single thing you do, and it doesn't matter what your favorite color is.
Very true.
Especially because you're not the target market. Your target market, do they like purple? That's who you have to care about, not what you like, not what the you know. So that's interesting too. Oh, I'm gonna turn this thing off so that we don't have this problem. Just go here. There we go.
Oh, there you go. Oh, changing angles. There you go.
Now I'm just normal. Not fancy anymore.
Hey, and I see you got a set of angel wings in the background.
Yeah, I do. Yeah. Oh, this way. Yeah, that's one of them. I got two of them.
Ah, brilliant. I get that. And like, the whole thing is, I think that's what a lot of people often do with their own lives. They put all of these bells and whistles onto their life, going, this is what I am, this is what I should be, this is how, take me all of this. But at essence, they don't actually like pull it all away and like look at what the sort of elegant self can be and go, yes, this is you.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I just love, my favorite thing, you know, I'm all the things you mentioned in the beginning, but I would say I am mostly somebody who wants to make sure I notice the sky at night before I go to sleep, you know, or the moon that's shining in the window, or, you know, it's just those little tiny things that matter most. And that I think that, and I do agree that I think simplicity is elegance. And I do, but you know, everybody's different and to each his own, you know, but that's me. I do really like sophistication and simplicity.
Yeah. Like sophistication and simplicity. Someone goes, hey, that is a contradiction in terms, but hey, but you know what I mean?
Oh, I don't think so, but I hear you.
Yeah.
Do you mean because like when you think sophisticated, you think shiny?
No, basically sophisticated, I like in some regards, it's complex. You get what I mean. And when like when you say like simple, it's like, yeah, it's, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
I used to think I was complex, but really I just think, oh, like, you know, when you were younger and, you know, liked a boy and they're always like, you know, you're too needy. I just like, well, they didn't understand. I was just wanty.
it's like wanty.
I wasn't needy. I just wanted what they couldn't give me.
Fair enough.
So, but that made me to them complex is what I was the point, but.
I can see that. I can see
that. But I guess, do you think women are complex? Most men do.
Like this is the thing. It's one of those things where, yeah. So there's part of me which goes, yes, women are complex. I go, yeah, it's like there's like you are confusing, you don't make any sense, like logic and reason doesn't like come to it. But one like that's what I would have said definitely. Through my younger years, yes, blah blah blah. But the whole thing is people are a lot simpler than they are. They go, yes, I'm this, I'm that, and this. It's like, yeah. But if you went 1, 2, 3 and you got those 3 key things sorted in anyone's life, and like you'd see their uptake in life change. Extremely, they'll be happier, they'll be satisfied, and like they'll like go forward with a new sense of purpose. But it's one of those things where, yeah, when you're young, like when you're young, dumb, it's like, yeah, you're just like, yeah, you tend to overcomplicate things. And look, I think people still today, you know what I mean?
Yeah, and I don't disagree with you. I think women can be confusing, even to women. So it's not like it's a man thing. But I think as we get older, we maybe get more, simplify what's important to us, which makes it easier for men. I hope that's true anyway. Mm. I don't know. My husband and I have got it figured out. So that's good.
But this is the thing. I think as you get older, with the course of time, you actually begin to know what truly is real value to you. Because look, there is, if you spoke to like your teenage self, it'll be scattered gun at best of what everything means and this and that. And when you sort of go to your 20s, you're like, yeah, it still would be that. In your 30s, it starts to cut down and go, okay, right, 40s, yeah. And then basically as each decade goes by, I think it's like, yeah, you get that real sense of priority. And because like this is the thing, you know, the film 4 Weddings and a Funeral.
Mm-hmm.
When you watch that, like if you watch that film for the first time as a teenager, you like go, what are you talking about? Mm-hmm. Just see your friends at weddings and shut up. In your 20s, still you'd be like, what are you talking about? Oh, that makes no sense. Late 20s, early 30s, you're like,
it's like,
it starts to ring true. And that as each time goes by, unfortunately, just because of life circumstances and everything like that, it becomes sometimes painfully true. That's the only times you can actually get friends together. Last time we had all my university friends together at one place, I'm going to say that was like my friend Sarah's wedding. And that was 2007. And like, so it's like, you know what I mean?
And especially during COVID, I mean, I feel a real sense of disconnection.
Mm.
and a loneliness that is not true, but still it feels that way.
Right.
Like, I know my friends are there, but I just haven't seen them in a while. So anyway.
Yeah. Like, this is a thing. You should like get them together. Like, yeah. Throw up,
right.
Like, throw up the Thundercat single snake and all, and like, yeah, get them to all assemble, you know?
Yes. It's time. It's time. Definitely time.
Mm.
Well, I just got together with my family at New Year's. And so 17 of us got COVID.
Oh, God. So how was that?
It was probably the worst vacation of my very expensive, worst vacation of my life. And so I took 3 weeks to recover. And anyway, so it's a real thing. I mean, getting together, I know it feels like I'm sick of it and I'm over it and I don't want to wear a mask anymore. But also COVID's real.
Well, yeah, COVID is real, and like, there's no joke about it, because like, yeah, I went to a friend's wedding just like first week in the new year, and I basically got COVID about 5 days afterwards. Like, basically, yeah. I think I managed to skate past it for almost 2 years, and it like tapped me on my shoulder, went, "It's your turn." I was like, "Bitch."
So anyway, I hear you. And I'm really looking forward to COVID being a thing of the past, or at least not deadly, so that, you know, it really took me out though for 3 weeks. So even though it wasn't deadly, it was still a pain in the butt.
Yeah, what I found with when I had like the COVID, it was a case of where I'd normally recover and like be able to sort of like, okay, I'm getting better. It was like, I'm okay. Oh no, I've made
exactly 100%. Every few days, I'd have hope, and then be like, "Oh no, I'm not okay." That's exactly it. Oh, that's really mean of COVID, too, isn't it? To give you a little fake hope.
Yes, it's like, you're getting better. Oh, you're okay. Ready for it? No.
Yeah. That's funny.
Yeah, now, I have to ask, this may be different to like how you did your graphic design. So when you went, okay, photography is going to be my thing, like building a business from that, did you find it easy, hard, difficult, especially with like just with the global pandemic kicking in at the same time?
Right. Well, graphic design still pays my bills, and photography has been a great second income, which I had never had a second income. I've been a graphic designer for 30 years and always joked that I had no other skill set. And so, you know, like I couldn't even be a barista. So, but this has been a lovely second income and also a source of pleasure for the art of it. And so it's just great. And so I am attracting the people that I'm supposed to attract. It's everything feels in alignment, you know, and I get to make art. And so hopefully one day I will get to be paid to travel to do photography. That's my ultimate goal. Mm-hmm. And someday retire graphic design, but also I'm really good at it. And so it's still paying the bills. So I might as well keep it as, and then maybe that'll be the second income, and photography will be my main income.
Yeah, I hear you. Yeah. Like, do you think you would ever sort of go into the realms of wedding photography or anything like that?
I have photographed two weddings already, and no, three. And I didn't enjoy it at all. It's not a pressure I want. You know, I'm all about play. And like I said, I really feel like I'm a seat of my pants kind of girl. I don't like to have it all planned out. And that's not the kind of person you need at your wedding.
Yeah, because like, this is the thing. Every time I've spoke, like I've had friends who are photographers, I've spoken to photographers, I've spoken to videographers, and like the whole thing is like, it's weddings is that sort of baptism of fire that everyone goes through, and it's just like, you're like, I would say over half of them have been like, no,
right. Right. Well, somebody just asked me for a quote because they saw my photography and they're like, "Oh my gosh, you're so beautiful. Do weddings?" And I gave them a very expensive quote because 100% of me doesn't want to do it. Yeah. Like if I'm going to do it, you're going to pay me really well. And so that didn't work out, which is great because it is not where my heart lies. You know, I would love to do the engagement photos where it's just, you know, those two and it's real moments, you know, that is okay. But the wedding is so stressful.
No, I hear you. I hear you. Because like, this is the thing. I look upon it and like, this is like, one of my friends was like, yeah, it's like, I mean, look, it pays good money. It like, do it for 6 months. Like,
yeah.
And then
yeah.
basically the rest of the year, you've got money for your own projects, live work. It's like, yeah. But
yeah, I don't know. It's just, I can tell that's not my calling and it would be silly to take my passion and then not do something I love with it. You know what I mean? So I don't want to do that. That's what I have to do with graphic design a lot. And so that's not what I want to do with the photography. I just want to do what I love. And that really includes that. My goal is to photograph just little kids playing around in dress up. Oh my gosh. I love taking pictures of kids dressed up, jumping around, playing, you know,
being that picture of Captain America. Little boy,
Captain America. Oh my gosh. He was not playing. He was Captain America. You know what I mean? He did not, he was not pretending. He was Captain America. So I just love that. I love little kids without self-consciousness. they're not aware of their roles, or their roles are just fine. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's a really lovely thing.
Brilliant. Now this is the thing. I wonder, you're doing your like series of angels and demons, say. Old Lucifer, old Nick. Yes. Look at you. That's like,
devilish angel. Yes. That's all. He just was devilish. Okay, like, look at me the way you look at me. And then it changed everything. Enough. Made you blush again.
All I've got to say is wing play. Say no more.
Yeah.
There you go. Mm-hmm.
I'm down.
Come in, you fool. Come in. It's like, see, it's like, hey. But yeah, with that, are you like, what do you have a preview or idea of what you might want to do after this series of photos?
Oh, I did have an idea. Now I can't remember it because I have so many of these angel ones lined up. but there's always, that's the fun of it. There's always something coming up. Oh, I have three women who want to dress up like Jackie O with pearls and stuff, and then go out on the town and just capture them like fancy women that they're not, you know, they're not really. And so I just love that I'm a photographer that's like, what ideas do you have? And let's go play. So I don't know. I'm open to anything. Any new ideas, I'm in.
Yeah.
See if I can do it.
Like the Jackie O. Like if you can get the classic Chanel dresses or anything like that.
Yeah.
Or like something what looks similar. Or like,
we'll see. You know, the fun part is these women are older. I would say, you know, late 50s, overweight. Probably in real life don't feel great about themselves, and yet they're going to look great in the photos, and they're going to feel fabulous, and we're going to play and have fun, and I'm going to show them their beauty where in every day they're not seeing it. And so I just love that.
Yeah.
It's fun to take pictures of models because they can't take a bad photo, but it's extra fun to take pictures of women who are, you know, a little older and overweight and show them their beauty where they're not seeing it every day in the mirror. Well, that's like, the real thing.
Yeah, because like this is the thing. When I looked at the like series 50 over 50, like 50-50, excuse me.
Yeah.
Yeah, like which goes from 50, 60, 70-year-old.
Yeah, movies. Yeah.
Now, the whole thing is like, yeah, you captured marvelous pictures where they looked all fantastic. It is one of those things where, like, because we're so sort of bombarded with, okay, the ideal, like, when it comes to photography, it's young and beautiful, and like, da, 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 like, if you're If you're 22, you might be over the hill for some photography places. But yeah, it's just like young, slightly innocent, not innocent.
Yeah.
Trusted out there again and again and again. And it ignores a large percentage of ladies out there. Would you, like, was this a case of that series was like you just championing that other side of things, or what was it? Like, what got that?
Well, the 50-50 was I interviewed Catherine Grace O'Connell, who has a group called Forever Fierce and Midlife Matters, and they're all women over 50. And I just love that there is more to midlife. You know, the 20-year-olds might not think it and they might be worried about it, but I have never felt so more me than at 50. You know, I didn't know who I was until near 50. So that's what sparked that. And then there was another one, Too Much Woman. And I interviewed Gina Hatzis, who did she was like a YouTube sensation, and she talked about being too much, too big, too bold, too sexy, too whatever. And that was really fun to have women tell me, or, you know, they've been told they're too whatever, and then show that in the photo.
Yeah.
There's another series my daughter inspired called See Me, where she was saying that she follows somebody on Instagram where they were holding up their signs that showed they're more than their diagnosis. And so we wrote words she chose for herself to say all the things she was, not how she looked, you know, all the things she knew about herself. And that sparked like 30 women to come in, people I didn't know, to really think about the words that described who they are. And in a lot of cases, very emotional, you know, calling themselves beautiful and having it, I hand painted everything on their backs and then took photos of them. And, you know, a lot of them were overweight, but to come pose for me half naked, I just met them. That was really emotional. And then one other series I did was called Real Men. I did that after the women. And that was so cool because we tried to capture each man in one photo, like who they are, you know, like one. And I just put this out there. I don't ask anybody and I don't suggest anybody. So that whoever just happens to see it. And there was a man who is a transgender man who transitioned at 30. And that was such a cool photo. And another one who is 38 and is a quadriplegic. He's never walked a day in his life. He was born with atrophy. I don't remember exactly, but, and that was just such a beautiful photo. It's just been really great experience to see what people are called to what series they're called to how they want to show themselves and be seen. And then as in the podcast, I feel like it's being heard. So I feel like I'm just telling stories in both cases. And then in graphic design, I'm professionally telling stories, you know, like, you know, for businesses telling their stories.
Yeah. A storyteller through and through. Visually and through like the word itself.
Yeah.
Like with that, like being a storyteller, do you find like that sort of responsibility, or like how do you treat that sort of like realm of responsibility?
Oh, well, I guess I take it seriously. Otherwise, I wouldn't take so long to edit either the photo or the podcast. I would just stick it out there. I just really want people to see the best versions of themselves. Mm. And I know I just did a podcast recently where I totally lost my train of thought and he doesn't edit. And so I'm just like babbling for a bit. And it's in my podcast. If it had been my podcast, that all would have been edited out and you would have sounded brilliant. I like that I can just put people's best foot forward is all I mean, is that, you know, all the ums and the likes, they're mostly edited out and we all sound brilliant. And in the photos, you know, nobody has a bag under their eye and their teeth are white. And in some cases their belly's pushed in a tiny bit, but you know what? That's the least I can do, I feel like.
You know, hey, I hear you.
Especially if they're willing to be so vulnerable, you know, especially the women who were taking their shirts off and being vulnerable and being naked. I was like secretly not telling them, helping a sister out. You know what I mean? Just softening their curves a tiny bit and never telling them that I was doing it because they were perfect just as they were. It wasn't to make them better. It was just so that they would love the photo better. You know?
Yeah, I hear you. Mm-hmm. Marvelous. Like, this is the thing. Like, with all of this going on, like, with, like, okay, your graphic design business, like, yeah, your photography, your podcast, like, yeah. How did you find time to, like, yeah, become an author as well?
Well, so in high school, I was always, when I was little, I had the Hara Herald. I've always been a writer. And, yeah. I was the editor of my school newspaper, and I started out in journalism actually before I went to advertising. But I kind of let it go. I feel like I'm a really good writer, but one who doesn't write. But I did write a couple of articles for a magazine, and so I'm a published author. But I know that I didn't know this, but I know that there's a book inside of me waiting to get out, and I think that might be next. That's exciting to actually say it, because I was asked that not long ago, and I was like, no. I have no plans, but the more I think about it, I really do think there's a book inside me.
Right. Do you have an idea what type of form this book might take?
Well, I have a feel. I mean, what I know, you know, it's going to be what I know, which means there might be, you know, and also what I like. And so what I like is deep and tragic. And so I think it will be in those vein.
Okay.
You know, but also write about what I know, which means write about me and my circumstances, but also the beauty I see, and also how there is hope no matter what you've gone through. That's my life message.
I hear you. And like, this is the thing, like, you seem to be like very well grounded and like, yeah, very much together. Like, you know, like, it's like, yes, fly by the seat of your pants. No, you just seem like, yeah.
Well, I think I appreciate that. I think the 35-year-old me wasn't. And so I have to stop saying that, because I think you're right. I think at this age, I am grounded and I am less seated by the seat of my pants. So that is true. I'm referring to the young me when I say that. And the work that I have done, even though it's been hard, has been really great. And I wholeheartedly suggest not living in your head and getting help if you need it, you know.
And like at 35, was that a case of what made you like, oh, hey?
I was in a terrible first marriage, and he was very mean to me about my weight. And then after I left him, I think I was around 32, a couple subsequent men actually said that it wouldn't work because of my weight was an issue. And I had to learn to love myself, even if society wasn't saying I was lovable.
Okay.
That was a real trick. I mean, that's really, you really got to get to know yourself and understand your heart and realize that you're not your body. But from, if I'm, you know, sexually abused at 7 and all the way through 40s, men are telling me that my value is through my body. It's a lot of work to know better. And so it took some work.
Yeah. I think it's one of those things where, like, yeah, when people talk about, yes, like the physical, like, it's like, yes, your body is what your calling card. This is who you are. This is your representative, first and foremost. Mm-hmm. I think we all fall into that trap at some point through like a myriad of like sort of insecurities over the course of time, which can hail from being bullied in school, to just basically, yeah, just having a number of just shitty encounters with some of the people we meet along the way.
Yeah.
But it's one of those things to okay, right, look. Okay, if this person saying it's about me. This is why we can't be together. But they initiated something in the beginning. So we started down this merry path. It's like, you kind of like go, if you really sat down and thought about it, you go, huh, wait a second. Was yeah. that just a coward's move to get out of a relationship? Or was it a deceptive move to like, I was like, yeah, I'm going to get what I want and I want to be out, if you get what I mean. I think
I think it's important to, you know, look back and think, well, I don't respect those people anyway. So what they said to me holds no value.
Yeah.
But also, you know, I went to one counselor. I had lent a guy all my money, like all my savings, $10,000. And he didn't pay me a penny. And every day for a year, I woke up pissed off. The first thing I woke up thinking was, this fucking asshole. Excuse me.
I know. It's all good.
But that's what I thought every morning. And then I went to this counselor and, you know, I'm all righteous. I was right that he was a jerk. But she just told me one thing that really changed the course of my life. She said, did he hold a gun to your head when you lent it to him? And I was like, well, no, but. But ultimately, there was no but. I had to take responsibility for my choice in giving this man, who I really knew better than to give him the money. And taking responsibility for that and ultimately forgiving the money and this, whatever I had to get, had to go on with my life, helped me forgive myself for past things, helped me forgive, or not forgive, but take responsibility for all the choices I've ever made and all the choices I will make. And when I realize it's up to me and my choices, that really helped who I was. And I was no longer a victim. And that, I think, is the key to freedom, is nobody really did anything to me along the way. I mean, when I was younger, yes, I was defenseless. But I mean, really, from 20 on, the poor choices I made, even if men took advantage of them, I allowed it. Mm. And that changes everything, knowing that. Nobody did hold a gun to my head. No, from very little, nobody held a gun to my head. So there were just a lot of poor choices along the way. And it's interesting to take responsibility for them. Even the men I dated that were jerks to me, I kind of knew they were jerks to begin with. So it's up to me to make better choices.
Yeah, I think that's one of the things. I think that's one of the things which is the key to people finding themselves and having that sort of long-term success. It's like, it's not taking responsibility for everything, because there are some things which you have no control over. But as you say, the choices you've made and stuff like this, if you know there's stupid choices and, like, you know what I mean? You're like, I done screwed up. What was I thinking?
Yeah.
And you take ownership and responsibility for those type of choices and go, yeah, this is what I did. It was on me. That person, yeah, but it was on me. I think that's when people can truly sort of take control. Until then, if it's like, it's that person's fault, it's that person's fault. Oh, no, right. It's that person's fault. You actually haven't actually taken a look at yourself, a good look at yourself in the mirror, because in the mathematical equation of life, you're the constant.
Exactly.
So it's like,
exactly. Yeah. I think 100%. And so that was about a decade ago, which means I was about 44. And that's what I'm saying. I really didn't know myself. I didn't have a sense of my worth until mid-40s. And so say I was 44. My mother passed away when she was 46. And so I just have this strong desire not to waste a minute of this beautiful gift I've been given, which is beyond 46. You know, I'm not going to beat myself up because I'm not a certain size. I do know my worth in terms of what I offer the world beyond what I look like. And that's what I hope to to share with everybody else, either visually or through their podcast, that, that you can go through things and also come out the other side and be, and that to me is beauty. That's what I mean when I said, I say, see beneath your beautiful. It's, I want to see inside. That's what your heart is. What's beautiful. Like your face could be crooked and still beautiful. You know, like I think it's not necessarily visual, your beauty.
I would say like, this is the thing, like back in the day, like, yes, like when blood ran hotter and like,
yeah,
I was a little bit dumber. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like the aesthetic would be the first thing what kicks into play. But sure, as you get a little bit wiser and then you sort of like get the whole sort of, okay, you might look like an oil painting and like, yeah, like pristine and perfect, but oh my God.
100%. I mean, every, you know, and it, you can be beautiful and lovely, but it's not necessary. You don't need to be both. I mean, you don't have to be lovely to be beautiful. You know what I mean? You don't have to be beautiful. You can be a lovely person. I think your light shines from, you know, from inside, and that's what makes a person lovely.
Yeah. I hear you. I agree. Yeah. No, yeah. Totally. That demon.
So, and not make an not apologize for it. You know, like I'm heavy right now and not apologizing that I'm heavy. I'm saying I'm beautiful no matter what I look like. Yeah. 50 pounds lighter. I hope not 50 pounds heavier, but if I was 50 pounds heavier, I'd still be me. You know what I mean? That's what you have to get to, that the constant. Okay. So today somebody asked me if I wanted to be in a support group for this diet. And I was like, oh my God, 100% no. One, I don't want to be on a diet. And two, if you need a support group, it's not the right thing to do.
Yeah.
I mean, I get taken care of what I watch, what I eat, taking care of myself. That all makes sense. But it just was really funny that she was talking about a support group and the, you know, like I don't think you should need a support group to eat. It's a funny thing.
So I go, yeah, I hear you. I hear you totally.
Yeah.
But like, this is the thing. I'm a person which like, okay, if you're going like people like, yes, if you're like a few hundred pounds on like fat, that's unhealthy. But if you're a few hundred pounds muscular, that's unhealthy too. So my vibe and my whole thing is, look, get healthy, be fit and healthy, be like, work on that first, because when
100%.
If you got your health, then you can then basically work on your intellect and then work on your skill set. If you don't have that,
right,
nothing comes together.
I agree. I think that is so important. And to look at what you eat in terms of how you're taking care of yourself instead of restricting what you're eating and, you know, it's a diet or whatever. I just think I'm taking care of myself and I'm eating, you know, I really eat really well and I play tennis and I'm just not a skinny person at the moment, but I probably will be again. And I'm not letting it dictate what, you know, how my life goes.
Mm-hmm. I hear you. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Brilliant. This is the thing. I get where you come from and I totally understand, because look, when we sort of let sort of, how can I say, obsessional negative things take hold of our lives.
Right.
It doesn't matter. Like, it's like, oh yes, wait, you get stuck. You go back to that quagmire and you stay there until you like get over that obsession. And this is the thing, being obsession the way it is, it's a hard nut to crack.
Well, one of the things that really made me take note of my body and my weight and the way I felt about myself was I have two daughters. Mm. And the oldest one said about, you know, maybe 6-7 years ago, something about, she's 26 now. So she was probably 18 or 19. She just said she doesn't like her body. And as a mom, you know, it breaks your heart because your kids are perfect. It doesn't matter what shape your body is. I just think you're so brilliant and beautiful and then I realized she was sounding like I was sounding. Like all she was learned behavior. I was constantly trying to change my body, saying I didn't like the way I looked, and had to change me for her to change the way she spoke about herself. And also I realized that I have to love myself the way I love my children. That I'm always doing my best. I'm worthy of love no matter what I look like. That, you know, you know how you would say to a little girl, oh, you're so smart, you tried so hard. Well, I'm still that little girl that's trying so hard and needs the accolades that, you're so smart. So I am just that kind to myself now. And I'm sad my daughter said it, but also so glad that I heard her and was able to change the dialogue.
Yeah, I hear that. And like, this is the thing, what I've often find, and this, like, I'm not a parent by all means, like one day, yes, but not at this present time. But like what I often see when I see my friends have kids and stuff like this, they forget that you're a person too. Like you're not just a parent. You're a living, breathing person. And when you sort of like just like, okay, right, I'm just doing the parent thing. Kids just like, okay, yes, right. But when like someone's like, I am a parent, but I am this and that as well, it's like, okay, that's lessons you're like passing on to your kids as well. So like when I do feel sorry for people when they do kind of lose themselves to that, but they're trying to be the best parent they can be. No one gives you, like, no one comes along and goes, okay, these are the classes you need to do to become a parent. Because it's like, you go, right, you might have, like, if you've got more than one kid, one might be like a cherub. That's like, yes, everything's fine. I'm listening to all your words. Thank you, mother. Thank you, father. You're great. Then the other one, like they're on the side of a mountain howling at the moon with wolves and old wild beasts, feral to the world. That's like, yeah. It's like, going, I cannot control this child.
100%.
You're like, going, yeah, you're both being brought up in the same household. Why are you so different from you? And
It's 100% true, because I had one crazy one and one docile one. And just when you think you know what you're doing, the other one comes along and changes everything.
Oh, hey. Yeah,
you're right, though. You're right.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's funny. Well, and also, my mom had six kids. I'm the youngest of six. And it was a crazy house when I was younger. She was single with six kids. The oldest was only 9 years older than me. So she had a lot of kids in a very short amount of time.
Good God.
And then she died when I was 18, and she wasn't even around when she was alive because she was overwhelmed with all these children. And it took me parenting my daughters as a single mom to really appreciate what you're saying about that they're people first and then happen to be parents. I keep telling my children that, like, I'm a girl who had kids with, like you said, no manual. Nobody tells you even have to take a class. You have more, you have to work harder to get a driver's license than to have a child, which is crazy.
Yes.
So just the business of being alive and parenting has really made me much softer towards my mother. And I do realize that we're all just doing the best we can. We're all just, you know, what skills you have, you know. She left the house the first time at 15 years old, got married. And so she just, you know, there's just no tools. She didn't know what she was doing. And therefore, I didn't know what I was doing.
Hey, but like this is the thing, you got to the other side.
Yes, that's the whole point, is took it one day at a time. There was some dark moments. And now you just called me grounded, which is a lovely thing to be called, you know, after all those years of the roller coaster. And so the hope is just that what happened was I interviewed, like, the third person I interviewed, I had taken photos of her. She's like 19 years old and she has a mental health diagnosis, like schizophrenia, like something bad, hard, not bad, hard. to deal with. And so I interviewed her for the podcast. She was just one of the first people I interviewed. And I realized she wasn't on the other side. And she was still, she's suicidal sometimes. And what my hope now is with the podcast, I didn't air her episode because I didn't even know what to say to her. I'm not trained. I had no idea. It was really a hard conversation. So what I realized is that I need to talk to people who are on the other side and can offer this girl in particular hope. I mean, I think of her every episode, like, what would you tell a 19-year-old who's suffering? You know, how is she going to get through to the next day? And so that's really how the meat of the podcast came about. At first, it was just, I realized people would tell me their, we would have vulnerable conversations. I realized that I'm easy to talk to. And that's how I had the idea for a podcast. But really, I've narrowed down the idea to how do we help this 19-year-old girl?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like basically like helping them find the path to the other side. Because like, this is the thing, I think, how can I put it? There are many people who have gone through life, through their ups and downs, through a myriad of different ways. And people often look at the finished article of that person's stage in their life and go, how am I meant to get there?
Right.
But with regards to this medium of podcasting, like long form conversations, you get more of a rich picture of how it's like, okay, yes, I am here right now. You see this finished article of myself, but to get here, you know, I went through this, I went through that, I went through this and this, this, and they'll list off all the things. And like, it's like, yeah, I had like, but I had this condition. And like, someone might go, oh, wait a second, you had one? And you managed to do this? It's like, right. And then all of a sudden you trigger them and they're listening more and more, right. Helping right. them find that path to get to that side. Obviously, life and circumstances are not going to be exactly the same, but now at least they've got some form of North Star, some sort of path to walk along. Because ultimately, if you really want to sort of get to like push yourself to new limits, you've got to kind of find your own path at the end of the day. But
you don't
need to be like, okay, I've just got to do it all by myself, because look.
Right. Well, you know, the last episode that I just aired was two episodes ago, was the 38-year-old quadriplegic male who, you know, I feel like if he can be positive, there's room for all of us to find the beauty in our life. If he has never taken a step and he's got a degenerative disease where, you know, every day something a little bit worse happens, and yet he's got a positive outlook. And so he was a really beautiful to interview, because that's the goal, is that we don't have to be a victim of our circumstance, even when we're going through it, even though our circumstance might suck.
Yeah, like this is the thing, when you're around someone who has true gratitude in their life, it's like a warm summer's day. You can't help but like, yeah, smile when you step out into it. It's not like, yeah, a scolding hot summer's day where you're out, but it's like, yeah.
I'm like, that's beauty, right? That's what's beautiful. That's what I think you're saying, is that, you know, somebody's full of gratitude and there's a light that comes off of them. That's what I think, is that you don't have to look a certain way and you don't have to have a certain amount of money. You don't have to, I mean, none of that matters ultimately, you know, it's just who you are.
Yeah. And you just got to be open to find those moments of gratitude, because they are all around us. It's just a case of we don't actually, how can I say, we are quite often blinkered to it. Through like, yeah, either through self-doubt or basically, yeah, just self-doubt, disbelief, or just hard times we're going through at that present time, which it's sometimes a sorry state, but it's just the way it is, you know?
Yeah, right. And, you know, the stories we tell ourselves, that we give them meaning. Like, you know, if somebody said to me today, I don't like you because you're fat, I'd be like, well, okay, that's fair. Like, you don't have to like me if that's, and if that's the reason, that's totally fine. I don't have to give it meaning. You know what I'm saying? I have, so that's what I mean, I guess, by taking responsibility, and it's all my choices. I can choose how I take in the information as well. You know what I mean? Like, you can say anything you want to me, and I don't have to, I mean, it doesn't have to mean anything to me. That's my choice.
The power of choice. Yeah, I hear you. I hear you. So I have to ask, where would you like this journey you're on? Which direction would you like it to go into?
Oh, well, I would love to continue to photograph people and show them how great they are. The podcast I have is really meaningful to me, just because I feel like those conversations are so important. Do you feel that way about yours? I mean, like, this is so meaningful to me, this conversation we're having. Like, I really enjoy just beyond the quick hellos and stuff. I just really enjoy this. So to me, that's really meaningful. I hope to continue that. To travel would be great, to, you know, to see the world with my husband, and to continue nurturing that relationship, you know, after a bad marriage, and he's had a couple bad marriages. I like that where we know to nurture this one, that we're, you know, older and wiser and take care of this. So I don't know, just continue to grow, continue to do the work. At New Year's, one of the questions that went around the dinner table was, how would you change the world? What are you going to do to change the world? And I totally say, do work on me. I can't change anybody else. The answer is, be good with me. And that will ultimately reflect into the world.
I like that. I like that a lot. Yes. And like, yeah, with regards to, for the most part, I think with regards to podcasts and like the conversations, like we have with people around the world in different places, I think it's a case of this. Like, we all, like, as time goes by, we all get sort of set in our ways. And that comes down to a lack of, over time, conversations we have with strangers and new realms and stuff like this. Because if you're in university and that type of environment, you're meeting new people every single day. You leave university, you're now more in your sort of family setting. If you get married, if you got kids, it's like, okay, let's just say, okay, any parent would agree, like, yes, like 70% of their time when they've got young kids under the age of 7 is more like, okay, right, herding cats and like, yes, baby talk and all that type of thing. And yeah, as time goes by, you get more and more set in your ways, just because you're not having these conversations where you might be exposed to new ideas, new realms of thinking, new ways of maybe pushing yourself to, like, yeah, something you may not have thought would be in your wheelhouse.
Right. But
when you have, like, when I have these conversations, I still have this ability now, which I've refound, to like be able to think differently, to think more broadly, to be open to a lot more sort of things and see new realms of possibilities where I can like potentially grow and get better in. That's what podcasting's done for myself, you know?
Same.
Same.
I feel like each one, even though they're just regular Joes, somebody said they weren't experts, but that's what makes it so good, I think. I think each one is like a mini coaching session for me, because I'm open to whatever they have to say and how are they getting through it. I always ask, you know, like, well, what do you do to stay positive? You know, so maybe I'll do that. Although I don't have a problem with it. I'm just saying the 19-year-old sticks in my brain. What can she do to get through to tomorrow, so she doesn't, when she's feeling terrible about where she's at, that she has a tool in her toolbox to get through to the next day.
Hey, if you're having conversations like the way I think you're having conversations, and if she takes the time to listen,
she might not.
If she does, like, yeah, like you never know. You may give her that one little tool what might get her past a really hard moment, a really tough period of time to get her through that day. It's like one of those things, like it's not the grand, great big leaps we take in life what make the difference. It's all of the small, like, stepping stones along the way what help build us, like help make us get stronger. And then when the leap happens, it's not so, like, if you take away all the stepping stones and you let go, that was the last stone and this is the stone you're going to, yeah, it is a big leap, but it's like dozens of stones, hundreds of stones, thousands of stones, millions of stones. It depends on the person at the time.
And they have to hear it at the right time. I totally get that. You know, the lady who told me I need to take responsibility, I was ready to hear her. I didn't take offense. I heard what she was saying, and that changed the course of my life, that those words. And so I know that it can be so simple. And somebody just say something to you at the right time, you hear it at the right time.
Excellent. Now, if there was a last question, it's been a wonderful time. Yeah. Now,
same.
Hey, if there was one epic project you could do in the next 5 years, and you had to make a choice between photography, like graphic design, podcast, or an author, which one would you pick?
I think it would be photography, and, you know, maybe some really cool series project. But when you said that, I remembered I did one podcast episode where I interviewed 12 women who've lost their mother. And it was so beautiful and powerful that it almost makes me wishy-washy about deciding it's photography, because those women and their stories and their voices and their love and their longing was so beautiful to me that it's a real toss-up now, because maybe I'll evolve into a video project where I get to combine both. Where you have people's words and you have these beautiful images, because I can't even pick.
Okay. Like I say, oh, interesting. I expect like grand things, you, m'lady.
Thanks. Yeah.
No worries. Interesting. Yeah. Can you tell the lovely people out there how they can find you on the interwebs?
Oh, sure. For my photography, it's Hara, H-A-R-A dot photography. And for the podcast, it's seebeneathyourbeautiful.com. And for my graphic design, it's studioh-creative.com. Perfect. Thanks for asking. Oh. Yeah.
Happy to do it. I'll put all of these notes into the, well, I'll put all of this into the description and the show notes, my friends, my life warriors. So yes, please seek out Hara. And yes, sign up if you can and listen to her podcast. Hara, thank you for coming on today. You have been wonderful.
Oh, good. Thank you so much. I really enjoyed the conversation.
Oh, me too. Yes. And I'd like to say thank you to you, my friends, my life warriors, for sticking with us up to the end of the show. Please stay safe, stay well, be awesome, be excellent, be fantastic. Be all the positive bees you can be in this world and then some. And hey, be awesome. Ha ha. Peace. And we are all.